very happy.
Of course.
Yeah, do you want a book?
मैम रुके
या
रुके स्ट्रेट या आप या मैम रुके मैम चलो
सतिंदर साइड में
मैं
सामने एकदम हाँ
बहुत थैंक उधर भी आ रहे थैंक उधर भी आ रहे
तो कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट टू सोशल कॉन्शियसनेस एक्चुअली आई कुड गो वन स्टेप फर्दर दिस इज अ बिग कैंपेन सोशल इज ऑल्सो डूइंग टू हेल्पिंग अस टू स्प्रेड द मैसेज ऑन मेंटल हेल्थ and happiness to the generation. I think most of the guys that who come here are our target population in the social. So first I'll request Devashri to say a few words.
Hi, good afternoon everyone. As the editor of the book, I would like to put the book in a very different context. In the context of Western philosophy and Western philosophers, many years back, in this early 1700s, French philosopher Descartes, who is believed to be the father of modern Western philosophy, he said, "I think, therefore I am." Three centuries later, someone else, another Frenchman named Jacques Lacan, would give a different spin to it. He would say, "I think where I am not, therefore I am where I do not think." That sentence is complicated, and what does it mean? And how does it tie up with Dog's book? What he meant by that sentence, among other interpretations, is this. He was referring to the unconscious patterns which compel us to behave in certain ways, repeat certain actions which we do not fully understand. And what he's saying that, unfortunately, these patterns that we repeat are not those of joy, but mainly they are those of grief, of sadness, and Dog is doing just that for you. He is actually helping you unravel those unconscious patterns, and he is actually offering you solutions. He is telling you how to be able to identify them, how to be able to laugh at them, and make peace with them. I will read from the book at one place when he says, "When I looked more carefully at the occasions when I had experienced betrayal by people close to me, I could see how often I had set myself up. I had taken select events and tweaked them until they fit into my script." So that is, I think, the essence of the book for me. And that is why I think this is a book for everyone. And I keep getting these questions from a lot of colleagues, from other people who have just started reading the book. They tell me, is it a parallel to the kind of work that Doc does with patients of substance abuse or with patients of depression? And it is not. It is not, because the unconscious patterns that we repeat are similar to all of us. For some people it could be drugs, for some people it could be sleepless nights, for some people it could be beating up your children. So I think it is a book for all of us, and once you read it, you'll discover a side to yourself that you've not known before. Thank you.
I'd like Riyadh to actually specify the role of social in this entire book launch.
Good evening, people. Thank you so much for coming out on a Saturday afternoon. And I think it will be an hour really, really well spent. I've known Doc for a while now. The first time I met Doc, he was this crazy man sitting in this funky room with Pink Floyd playing in the background, chain smoking away. And the first thing I remember seeing was this beautiful poster in the back of this song called Wish You Were Here. And Kriti Monga right here had actually designed that. And I was like, man, this guy is so cool, because I was really, really impressed by the music playing and as well as the poster over there. And I thought it was incredible. And, you know, the more I got started talking to Doc, I thought he was this brash man, you know, loud, obnoxious, slightly bordering on irreverent. But, you know, I think that the more I started talking to this man and I started realizing that there's absolutely no BS, no jargon, no bullshit, no heavy psychiatric, psychological big words that people keep using. It's just a man who feels just the way that you do and has had the same experience that you do and has this deep sense of empathy for people around him, and also not just has a deep sense of empathy but also has, through his own journey, been able to figure out the route to happiness, in a sense. And I mean, this man is just, he wears his heart on his sleeve. He's smiling one minute, he's just crying like a baby the next minute. And I think that he's really living life unafraid. And with social, we get a chance to work a lot with millennials. They are our customers. They help us develop the product. They work with me in the office. You know, they're very inspiring. But at the same time, you know, there's also a kind of restlessness or a sense of sadness that I sense coming from them. And I think that it is in part contributed to this kind of life fully exposed on social media, where you just have to have a perfect life. You know, I think I read an article just 2 days ago about how Instagram was making people depressed. Because everybody seemed to have this perfect life, this awesome, they were doing all these fantastic things, they had all these awesome friends, they had all this awesome fashion sense and stuff. Even I look at them and I'm like, damn, I really need to get a stylist or something, or I need to get a better haircut, or I need to get better clothes, or I need to get a better watch, or I need to go on holidays, because it was just, everybody seems to be having the life of my dreams, actually. So, And just to see, you know, this kind of deep-rooted anxiety of FOMO, which is fear of missing out, LOMO, which is you live only once. Maybe I'm getting them wrong, but YOLO. And this need to always be doing something, and it kind of takes a toll on you. You know, it makes, and I have seen it at a personal level. His ability to get through to people, you know, to these really hard, almost inscrutable nuts to crack. You can't just get through to some people. And I don't know how he does it, but he gets through to them. And not only does he get through to them, he transforms them. So people who have been part of his family will always be part of his family, no matter which part of the world they are and how far removed they are. I have never seen this kind of loyalty. What social is going to do with this group? Sorry.
So now, I think everybody, you know your Manisha Koirala. I'm going to introduce my Manisha Koirala. The way I know Manisha, she is the most beautiful human being that I have experienced. Entire life. She's a child. I think we should call her Manisha child. No, really. And for anybody who can experience, I don't know if you know this star, I don't know that star, I know this friend, I know this person who is a very, very good person. And I think they couldn't have been a better person to launch my book other than this human being who's sitting on my left looking so hot. So before she speaks, I would I would like her to actually unveil the book.
Yeah.
now I request Manisha to talk about, it's very important, whatever she feels like.
Whatever makes her happy.
Good evening, everyone. I've known Doc over the years, and when he calls, I cannot say no. And it's always a pleasure, it's an honor, because he said that I am a good human being. I think one of the world's best human beings is him. He's really has helped many people. The one core thing that I adore about Doc is his love for people and his honesty, earnesty, and I love the way he thinks. I love his mind. And so I'm really keen. I haven't really read your book, but I'm really keen to know more about happiness. Through our long conversations over the years, and I remember we had this debate and this thing about life's purpose and meaning of life, and you shared a few things. So I'm really keen to know what you've written. I wish you all the best for this book. I'm sure it's going to help many people. And that's that. And yeah. Thank you, Doc. Thank you so much. Good luck.